立法會主席。
The President of the Legislative Council. Good morning. We'll continue with the debate on the motion under Article 73. Mr. Wong Kwok-kin, I don't think we have a quorum here. Yes, please have a quorum count, please.
Thank you.
是否有議員想發言?
Does any member wish to speak? Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. Thank you, Mr. President. I'm not a legal professional, but as far as I understand it, I would like to ask the Secretary for Justice to talk about the procedures involved in prosecution. I'm a layman. I understand that should somebody be suspected of having committed a crime, then we need somebody to complain to a law enforcement agency. And a complaint has been received. If it is believed that a file has to be opened to start investigation, that will be done, and then they will look into it. When evidence is found, then the prosecution will be asked to look into it. That is, the Department of Justice will be asked to look into it. Now, investigation and prosecution have to be carried out in the most cautious manner. And then it will be followed by a trial by the court. And then the court will decide whether the case is proved or not. I think that's how the matter is taken forward. I just want to ask the Secretary to confirm whether this is the case. Now, if the investigating body is of the opinion that there is no evidence or the evidence cannot be, or there's no evidence to substantiate the complaint, then the case will not be referred to the DOJ for prosecution. Now, for the motion before us, let's go back to the root of the matter. As far as the case of the UGL, am I right to say then, it depends on whether the ICAC has got evidence or sufficient evidence? Please clarify this point. If it is a matter of insufficient evidence, and still you force or you urge the DOJ to press charges, would it be right, procedurally speaking? So I would like to ask the Secretary to clarify this point for our own sake as well as for the sake of the public. At the same time, I understand that we have got fellow lawmakers who went to the UK and Australia to carry out an investigation themselves. Now, they are so anxious about the case. What have they made out of it? We don't know. And then for the investigation involved, I think both the public as well as myself are really interested as to what evidence has been collected. According to the media reports, I think such members raised money by way of crowdfunding to pay for their trip. Do they have to go to the UK or Australia again for investigation? If they want to have another round of crowdfunding, I will be interested and happy to help. I'm not sure whether they traveled on economy class, business class, or first class. I think since they were funded by the people, they should give an account as to the expenses, like the accommodation as well as the air tickets. They didn't make an announcement about the outcome of their trip, say whether there is evidence or not. Well, they're saying that it is wrong for the Secretary not to press charges. However, I understand that the ICAC has published a statement. So I find it strange. In the absence of evidence, why are they insisting that the DOJ must prosecute the person involved? I think they're putting the cart before the horse. Now, today we're having this motion debate, and I hope that the mover will make it clear as to what has been established from their investigative trips to the UK and Australia. Well, they have been funded by the crowd, so I don't think it is right for everything to be done in a black box sort of manner. I think they owe their supporters a clear answer. So they need to tell us what they have found. I look forward to the mover giving an explanation in this regard. I think he has to give an account to the people of Hong Kong. I think even colleagues here should be given an answer, and the S of Secretary would also want to hear from that.
Dr. Junius Ho. President, in relation to Mr. Dennis Kwok's motion pursuant to Section 73 of the ROP to summon the Secretary of Justice to appear in counsel to testify and to produce documents in relation to the decision not to seek legal advice. And I am of the view that this request has no legal basis, because Article 63 of the Basic Law is very clear, although it's been quoted by members a number of times. Let's take a look at Article 63 of the Basic Law, which states, the Department of Justice of the Hong Kong SAR shall control criminal prosecutions. And the last four words are free from any interference. Free from any interference, meaning interference, including interference from this council. Can the council move a motion pursuant to Article 73.5 asking the secretary to testify or give evidence? Under the Basic Law, there is no other accountable officer that enjoys the same powers as the Secretary for Justice, as in Article 63. That means the Secretary is in ultimate control, free from any interference from anyone, including the Chief Executive. Even the Chief Executive cannot interfere with her prosecutorial decision in relation to a case. Not even the CE can query her decision. So she is given the exemption from any interference from anybody. However, there is another article in the Basic Law in relation to the judiciary. Article 85 of the Basic Law, a very similar provision. The courts of the Hong Kong SAR shall exercise judicial power independently, free from any interference. Please note, free from any interference. Members of the judiciary shall be immune from legal action and the performance of their judicial functions. So there is judicial independence clearly laid down in Article 85 of the Basic Law. And for the rule of law, we have to ensure a free judiciary. And as for prosecution, if the secretary is under pressure politically to sue a certain person, then Article 63 gives the Secretary for Justice this privilege to be free from interference from any person. In the past few years, in relation to Siwa Leung's case, Mr. Lee and also Mr. Wong Ting Kwong have put it very clearly. In the past few years, they have been persecuting Siwa Leung politically. As a matter of routine, they complained to the ICAC, they wrote articles on his case, and they tried to invoke the Electoral Powers and Privileges Ordinance to investigate the case to no avail. And then they have also petitioned to have an investigation. Now, ICAC has completed its investigation. Well, 4 years back in December, four years after the event, a statement was made by the S4J, and they would like to ask why the secretary hasn't sought outside legal advice. Which provision in the basic law requires her to do so? Under 63, she shall control criminal prosecutions. If she finds herself incompetent, she can seek outside legal advice, but she's fully confident that she can handle it. Why should you force her to seek legal advice? What is your basis and justification? Don't forget that policy is a policy. It is a policy set by the DOJ. Does the secretary have to comply with that policy? It's just guidance for his officers in the DOJ. The secretary is finally the person responsible. Now, Mr. Dennis KWOK, there is a decision by the Court of Appeal 10 years ago. But 10 years down the road, can't the Court of Appeal overturn its own ruling? Now, you are from the legal profession.
Their own decision. Hierarchy.
And Mr. Evan Yang said that why don't we invite the secretary to come and testify? Because we have to act in accordance with the basic law and not according to what you prefer. Otherwise, the result would be disastrous. You claim that you act in accordance with the law, but you don't really respect the basic law, just like the national anthem yesterday. You protested at once at the first reading of the bill on national anthem. Were you asked to sing the party song? No, you're so confused. In 2008 or 2012, when I first joined direct elections, I said, what's wrong with being patriotic? And Audrey Yu, Senior Counsel or Queen's Counsel, said that nobody asked her to love the party. And loving the country means loving the party. And I said, nobody has asked you to love the party. We're just asking you to love your country. How can you equate loving the party with loving your country? If Queen's Counsel can't even sort out this logic, does our Secretary for Justice have to really seek outside legal advice for such a simple case with the investigation result from ICAC? Now, if that is the standard of Queen's Counsel, it's better not to seek their advice. In the past 4 years, no, not really. In the past 20 years, you've been very hostile to the fact of unification with our country. You act as if being reunited with your country is an insult to your families. Point of order. What is your point of order? We are debating my motion on summoning the Secretary of Justice to come and explain the CY Leung case. And Dr. Ho is now talking about the national anthem and what happened during his first reading. Is it relevant? You have made your point of order. Please be seated. Dr. Ho, please return to the debate. Once again, well, when you are being accommodating, they are very mean. Very often, they like to digress and make irrelevant remarks in debate. Now, they have this motion on the SFJ. Do you think it is really about the matter? No, it's because they are not happy with the Secretary for Justice. It's pointless for you to stage such a drama we're going to vote down this motion. You are just staging a political show. Now, it's not that we are supporting her blindly. We support her with justifications. You call us loyalists. And as Dr. Priscilla Leung said, oh, you said you asked voters to be careful when the next elections come because of what Dr. Priscilla Leung said. You come to this council to seek relief and ask us to pass this motion pursuant to Article 73, 5, and 10. You must be honest.
But I don't think that you are qualified. 一路以來,
all along, you have been making frivolous and vexatious requests. Would you like to speak in English? Let me teach you these two English words. This motion is frivolous and vexatious. You have staged meaningless, pointless political struggles at this very august chamber. Well, I was using the national anthem as an example. Why? What is your basis for opposing the bill on national anthem? Please return to the debate, Dr. Ho. I just want to elaborate on the fact that what they've been doing has no legal basis at all. Although the report by the subcommittee of this council has yet to be published, but I think I can expect that it will not have any conclusive findings. As Mr. Wong Ting Kwong said, you have raised funds by crowdfunding. Well, why don't you or chip in 3 months of your salary from 20 members, that is close to $300,000. You multiply by 26, and that would be sufficient funding. And Claudia Mo can also ask her husband to chip in. Crowdfunding, please give us a clear account of how the money is spent. You're not qualified to challenge the secretary for not doing a good job. Yesterday, Tetoy was mumbling. He mumbled about the secretary, and then Tanya Chen also stood up to criticize the secretary. You like to launch personal attacks, and when people criticize you, you at once stand up to protest. Well, do to others as you would like others to do to you. All right, I will not continue any further. This application has no legal basis. Ms. Claudia Mo, you have been speaking in your seat a number of times. Can you please keep quiet? If you would like to debate, to join in this debate, you've already done your turn. Ms. Claudia Mo, please don't continue to speak in your seat. Quiet, please. Dr. Junius Ho, thank you, President. I don't mind her speaking in her seat. Anyway, that's her attitude, but I thank the President for your very smart ruling. Article 63 is overriding, and Article 73, 5, and 10 doesn't apply to the prosecutorial decision by the Secretary for Justice because of the four words in Article 63, free from any interference. Do we have similar overriding provisions in the basic law? Yes, there is. The Secretary for Justice shall be free from any interference, but she has to face her political accountability if she doesn't do a good job, the central authority has the power or authority to remove a political appointee from his office. Although the Court of Final Appeal has the final power of adjudication in Hong Kong, if the basic law is violated, then the MPCSC has the supreme authority to do something. In any event, the Central People's Government has the power to appoint and remove political appointees. Enough is enough. The Secretary for Justice has made the final decision on CY Leung's case. She is of the view that no outside legal advice is needed. For people from the legal profession who talks about protecting the rule of law, in fact, they are undermining the rule of law in Hong Kong. And regrettably, we have this motion in front of this council. I will for sure vote down the motion. Thank you.
Ms. Al Dohin, President. What Dr. Junius Ho just said triggered me into giving some words. And he said what he said is the truth, and what we said was not. And when you talking about judicial independence, the Democrats here are not asking the DOJ to be constrained in every decision, because you are facing the Hong Kong public and not just LegCo. You said it was not lawful in the past, but what about the cases involving Franklin Lam, Timothy Tong, and Anthony Leung? So were those cases unlawful because outside advice was sought? If that was the case, why did the former SJs did that, but Teresa Chang did not seek outside advice for CY Leung's UGL case? I think there is a lot of hypocrisy at this council, because a lot of pro-Beijing members said that Teresa Chang has been foolish. She should have sought legal advice, but then as they speak here, well, they do, well, just remember what they say in private to ourselves and the media. I'm sure we all know about it. When we look at this case, the DOJ issued a statement to explain why they did not pursue prosecution, and he said there was no evidence showing that DTZ cannot be confirmed as not agreeing to the payment. So who gave the consent? So it is the truth that CY Leung received a payment from UGL on behalf of the company. Without, if the consent was not from him, where was it from, or who was it from? The chief executive receiving this payment constituted potential conflicts of interest. So that is the gist of the case. But according to the statement, it only mentioned the absence of consent. This case involved a number of procedures. When you decided not to seek outside advice, to quote what Dr. Junius Ho said, the DOJ might feel that they are already capable. And Dr. Ho said, unless the DOJ does not have the competence, they would not have to seek outside advice. This is about convention.
Legal dignity 你現在破壞了 legal dignity 我們就說你以前那個掛
Now you're jeopardizing the legal dignity. Why didn't you go, why didn't you take this extra step? You said there was no legal basis, but such claim is ungrounded. To borrow what Mr. Porcher said last night, well, I wrote down what he said. He cited a number of court cases. He mentioned whether there is any ground for judicial review taken against the DOJ, and he gave a few justifications. So let's revisit the cases he mentioned. He said that the policy is unlawful, and as such, a judicial review can be filed. And as for, well, he also cited past convention, and he said that the case was frivolous. And number four, the motive involved in the case. I hope I quoted him correctly. If my interpretation was correct, you said you deviated from past practice, and this is what our main query is. And you said it was unreasonable. Former chief executive Donald Chang received a different kind of treatment as CY Leung. Why was there such difference? You said that accusations from the Democrats have no legal basis. I think you should see whether these arguments are valid. Mr. Dennis Kwok's motion serves to tell the public how the DOJ should handle cases and explain their decisions. Thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Porcher, point of order. Yes, Mr. Ao quoted me. I don't mind if he quoted correctly, but then he's been confusing. So let me clarify. He referred to four points. First of all, if a policy is unlawful, if a policy hasn't been followed, and then if he couldn't get me correctly, in fact, I was talking about being unreasonable, and then I also talked about bad faith. Dr. An Zhang, Mr. President, I think this is totally unnecessary. Mr. President, I just wonder whether you should have given permission to allow the debate to be started. I think Article 63 of the Basic Law says very clearly the work of the Department of Justice should be free from any interference. Now, for the Legislative Council to summon the Secretary for Justice and ask her to explain why she is pressing charges against this person and decides against prosecution against another person, then it is tantamount to interfering with her decisions and asking her to justify her decisions. Now, the mover is Mr. Dennis Kwok. I think everybody knows which sector he represents. Now, he challenges the SJ, wondering why she hasn't engaged an independent legal advisor. I think directly or indirectly, it may involve a conflict of interests. So for Dennis Kwok to move this motion, I think this is most unwise on his part. Mr. President, I went over the details of the case. since the announcement, I tried to find out whether we did have such a convention. And I would like to find out when we talk about a sensitive case, a senior public officer or a celebrity, then we have to engage independent legal counsel to advise us. I have consulted the views of a person who used to occupy a very senior post in the department, but he has already retired. He told me that, of course, the DOJ must screen all the cases. They are responsible for the first tier of the work, so to speak. So first of all, they have to establish whether there is sufficient evidence. If it is found that there is sufficient evidence, or it is nearly there, or it is a 50-50 case, then at this moment, if they believe that the person involved may involve public interest or it attracts a lot of public attention, then they may need to get a third party for legal advice. So the main purpose is to get a legal opinion. That is, if the government would like to take up this case, is there a chance of successful conviction, the approach to be adopted, and the verse and chapters to be invoked. So it's a matter of having a discussion how to carry out the prosecution properly. Time and again, the SJ has told us that there isn't evidence. I believe that we have got a two-man band, that is Lam Chek Ting and Andrew Wang. They went to the UK, they went to Australia. They talked to the relevant lawmakers and the relevant organizations. They lodged a complaint saying that they should agree with them so as to press charges against the persons involved. And all the time, the requested party asked for sufficient evidence to be produced. I think a few years back, I, together with Claudia Mo, had a meeting with Australian parliamentarians. Claudia Mo asked the Australian lawmaker to pay attention to this case. Again, the Australian MP asked for evidence to be produced, and then we have been they have been waiting for 3 years. Recently, I met the Australian MP again. He said that so far he hasn't received any evidence. So it begs the question, is there any evidence at all? In addition, this has happened for quite a while for the law enforcement agencies in both the UK as well as Australia, the UGL, DTC, as well as the RSB, they were not able to have any follow-up action, all because of the lack of evidence. So in the absence of evidence, it means that you cannot pass the first line, so to speak, that is the Department of Justice. In this case, you're justified to look for a second opinion from a third party. It's easy to engage an external legal opinion. Well, some members have even said that it doesn't matter, it's easy, just go to look for a third party. Well, if they find a local senior counsel who apparently looks like a supporter of the pro-establishment camp, will they accept his opinion? No. They will say that they don't have trust in the DOJ, they don't have trust in the senior counsel engaged by the DOJ. They can easily think of all sorts of excuses. Well, maybe they want us to spend 10 million or dozens of millions of dollars to engage a senior counsel from the UK or Queen's Counsel. Well, brothers, sisters, we don't spend our public money in this way. Now, recently, we were supposed to look at the rationalization of the tunnel traffic. I've been told that it's a simple issue, it's an easy question. there's no case for consultancy work. Do you know that many public officers are anxious and worried that they may easily get the criticism? And that's why, whether we are trying to think of a new policy or not, they try to engage a consultant to give recommendations, and we have rounds of consultation. In fact, the public officers involved can competently carry out the work, but then they are just afraid of criticisms from you. So they have developed a habit to get consultants for each and every task. And year in, year out, we are spending lots of money on consultancy work. So I have to say that you don't lightly resort to consultants. It is a waste of money, a waste of taxpayers' money. Therefore, Mr. President, many Legislative Council members have said that they do respect the independence of the judiciary. But then this example illustrates that they have got double standards, and they will move the goalposts to where they like. During this debate, have you ever shown any respect to the judiciary? Do you respect the SJ? Do you respect the independence of the SJ? Do you respect her decisions? If we support Mr. Dennis Kwok's motion, I'm afraid we are going to start a very bad precedent. I will urge everybody to be cautious and don't do anything that you will regret. Thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Wong Kwok Kin. President, at first I didn't intend to speak, but in the past couple of days, I have been entrusted by some friends to put some questions to Mr. Dennis Kwok. So I have no choice but to put these questions to Mr. Kwok to be accountable to the public. In fact, one question was asked by Dr. Ann Jiang already. The first question I have been entrusted to ask is there any conflict of interest? As we all know, when independent legal advice is sought by the Secretary for Justice, a huge sum of money is involved. Silence, please. Mr. Dennis Kwok is a barrister, and he is also a representative of the legal sector. I don't know whether there is any conflict of interest involved. It's not that I query you, Mr. Kwok. I've been asked by a friend to put this question to you. Secondly, the Secretary for Justice shall control criminal prosecutions free from any interference. Now, Mr. Kwok and also the PEN Democrats he represents, are they intimidating the SVJ? Does the Secretary have to listen to your views in the future in prosecutorial decision? And the SVJ doesn't accept your advice, she'll have to be summoned to this council. So is this a threat to the Secretary? At first, I had doubts as to the views of my friends. But having listened to speeches from the Democrats this few days, I tend to agree to them because there is nothing in their speeches to challenge the basis for her decision, that is insufficient evidence. Rather, they are challenging why the Secretary hasn't sought independent legal advice, because they have no evidence to challenge the SJ's decision. They have no evidence to show that the case should be prosecuted but decided against. So they shift the focus. They challenge the SJ for not seeking independent legal advice, and that is the crux of the matter. I think we have to return to the basics. It is the secretary has decided not to prosecute. That must be because of a lack of evidence. And yet, they are not challenging that point. They are challenging why external legal advice is not sought. And they speak as if the S4J has committed an offense or has made a mistake in not doing so. Now, I would like to refer to an editorial. I won't name the magazine, but I will quote one paragraph from the article. The S4J recently made a statement on Siwa Leung's case saying that because of a lack of evidence, there won't be any charges pressed. That has caused an uproar among the pan-democrats. And in fact, the S4J under the law has the power to make a professional decision as regards whether external legal advice should be sought. Well, there are clear guidelines within the DFJ. The remarks of the SJ has been severely distorted, and our rule of law and administration of justice have been undermined. Whether it be investigation by our ICAC and Australian and UK authorities, such accusations do not have sufficient evidence, but this has given rise to big controversies, and what are the reasons for that? Analysis will tell us that the UGL case has been highly politicized. Political parties and politicians from the pan-democratic camp have been following the UGL case for 4 years. Whether it be towards UGL or CY Leung, their speeches have been highly personal, and there are ulterior political motives behind all these. Now, when people are so sensational and biased, this will affect the judgment of the case. Some people might have already formed a judgment on Siwa Leung's case or UGL's case, and they might have already established a case for UGL, and therefore they have found DOJ's decision not to prosecute unacceptable. The fact is, there is no sufficient evidence, and they cannot refute this. Now, please pay attention to the sentence. The fact that there is insufficient evidence, and this is something you cannot refute. And the fact that the S4J has not sought legal advice and from outside counsel has become their new focus. On this point, there are divergent views within the legal profession. So that is a quotation from one of the paragraphs of the editorial. This motion is entirely frivolous. I had no intention to speak on it because we have been talking about this topic for a number of years, and an investigation committee has been set up by a petition, and the subcommittee has been in operation for 2 years with no results at all, meaning that there is no progress, there is no evidence unearthed, no new information, and is planning to wind up its work. So they challenge the DOJ for not prosecuting UGL case is against reason. They ask how come independent legal advice has not been sought. I think it's just a matter of common sense. Because there is no evidence, the DOJ has decided not to prosecute. This is such a simple matter. Doesn't DOJ have this simple professional knowledge, but as set out in the editorial, because they are biased, they already ruled the person concerned guilty, and yet they cannot really challenge the fact that there is no sufficient evidence, and therefore they have shifted focus and therefore attacked the secretary for not seeking outside legal advice. President, the FTU will not accept Mr. Dennis Kwok's highly politicized interference with the DOJ's decision. We will oppose Mr. Dennis Kwok's motion. Thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? Ms. Eddie Hsu. Thank you, President. First of all, what Mr. Wong Ting Kwong and Mr. Wong Kwok Kin could clarify parts of their speeches. According to Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, the motion seeks to make the DOJ change their prosecution decision, but that is not the truth. The request is for the SJ to produce the relevant records and documents, and to testify or give evidence on her handling of the case. And for Mr. Wong Kwok Kin, what he said was the opposite. He said there is no evidence otherwise to prove that CY Leung is guilty, so they shifted the focus to procedures. But indeed, we are dealing with procedures, so Mr. Wong Kwok Kin was not wrong. We are looking at procedures. That is why we are not saying that Teresa Cheng is wrong, because we are following Article 73 of the Basic Law. This is something we have to make clear first. Yesterday, I followed Mr. Paul Chair's speech. His speeches are usually well justified and grounded, so I'd like to address what he said. First of all, Mr. Chair said this is an unprecedented request. Due to the fact that three previous SJs never had to attend before LegCo and produce all the documents under the Basic Law. I think what Mr. Paul Chair said, that this is an unprecedented request, which is excessive. We were making this unprecedented request because we are facing this undesirable situation, which is also unprecedented. The public might have the feeling that this incident was bad from on an unprecedented level. We have never seen any former chief executive who struck an agreement with a company and continue to receive payment right up to the point when that person assumed office. UGL is not an ordinary company. It involves a lot of commercial services and projects. So while CY Leung was in office, he did not make any declaration. So were any of his acts related to the payment or this company. Unlike what Mr. Wong Kwok-kin said, there are doubts that there might be issues associated with this case, and this is something the public could see. CY Leung received a $15 million payment, and the public felt that the case was more complicated than the Donald Chang case. For Donald Chang's case, it was simply a rich man who received a lot of perks, and he received a number of perks while he was still in office. But for the CY Leung case, it is very complicated. This is a constitutional issue on the declaration requirements for the CE. The public would recall that this is a very protracted criminal investigation for the case involving Clarice Chu. After going through the independent police complaints council, it only took about a year, but this case has taken 4 years. So eventually, what would the public expect? We expected the case to be handled properly. At least you should follow the convention of the three previous SJs with regards to treatment towards senior government officials. For as with the case of Clarice Chu, he was only sued near the point of retirement. The case of CY Leung is unprecedented in terms of the actual circumstances as well as the time required, and the and it's the same for the case of Franklin Chu. And Mr. Paul Chair mentioned the case of Sally Orr and the then Secretary for Justice L.C. Leung set a precedent at the time. A Pandora's box was open, and he also cited the former S.J. Thomas A. or Attorney General Thomas, and for the former LegCo member Ronald Akali also left out of anger. But I want to say that what A.G. Thomas and Ronald Akali said might not necessarily be right. But we are talking about a precedent starting from the case of Sally Orr. After 1997, the DOJ had to explain to LegCo and the public their decision whether or not to prosecute and the criteria they consider in considering briefing out. So these are certainly precedents, but are these good precedents or bad ones? I think these are good precedents. From the public's reaction, I'm sure our common concern is on the credibility of our judicial independence. Have we reached a state in which we no longer trust the system? For these precedents raised by L.C. Leung, did they jeopardize the credibility of our judicial independence, or was it conducive? I think those decisions were conducive. An open approach was adopted, and when there was a perceived conflict, outside advice from SCs were sought, so these were certainly good precedents. On another hand, Mr. Porcher was worried about the prospect of a public trial, but for the case of CY Leung, if Teresa Cheng decides to make a decision behind closed doors without seeking advice from outside FCs, would this actually help or hurt CY Leung's image? I think it has tarnished CY Leung's reputation. Offering more information does not amount to a public trial, and even a public trial might not have negative connotations. You have deviated from the practice of the three previous SJs, and the effect is that the person involved, CY Leung, has seen his image tarnished in the eyes of the public. Dr. Junius Ho and other members mentioned Article 63 of the Basic Law, so we should be honest. The phrase free from any interference, if you ask any member of the public today, regardless of their political stance, everyone knows that the condition free from any interference does not include interference from Beijing. Why was a prosecution decision only made after 4 years? We are talking about a national leader. If you choose to prosecute a member of the CPPCC but not another, it would not be a purely judicial decision. For such political decisions, everyone knows what you are doing behind the scenes. But we are talking about procedural justice. The motion is about due process rather than the end result. Even if we know that this is a political decision, why did you show the public through the procedures that you were harboring CY Leung? My view is that on CY Leung, Beijing would not allow any counsel outside of the DOJ to be involved in the case. And that was why there was a decision made which deviated from the approach adopted by LC Leung, Rimsky Yun, and Wang Yanlong. So it is all political. For the pro-establishment camp, well, let me cite an example. For the co-location arrangement of the high-speed rail, we said that it breached Article 18 of the Basic Law. So what was the justification? Mr. Porcher said that even if you are to justify it, at least you must seek interpretation of Article 18. So you made a political decision, there was nothing we can do, but you should not do anything which would seriously undermine our system. So the counter suggestion is that you should resort to Article 158 of the Basic Law, and the same goes for this case. We know that your decision to not prosecute was a political one. But when you explain the decision to the public, can you not further undermine our system? As Mr. Paul Chair said, you have the guidelines and your decision might be subject to HAR. So while the government or probation camp accepts political missions from the Beijing, you are seeking to achieve that goal in the worst possible way. And in the process, you have jeopardized our system and affected public confidence. Thank you.
Mr. Abraham Sheikh.
Mr. President, any motion that being brought to this House and successfully dividing the House worth our serious study. The motion on the floor, as introduced by Dennis, I think it's very appropriate that he bring this whole motion for discussion so that we can draw an end to the dark clouds hanging over Hong Kong for the last 4 years in the name of UGL and CY Leung saga. The issue at stake is that it has dragged on for so long, and justice being delayed is justice overdue. And in this manner that the Secretary of Justice actually bring it to an end by giving her judgment and a decision in December last year. I'd like to speak on the motion that some of my colleagues from the pro-establishment side said that it's a waste of time. This is not a waste of time. This is actually putting the rule of law into practice, putting the basic law, the rights that are given to us in the basic law, rights of freedom, right to challenge government, right of expression, into the open. We are telling the world that the rule of law is active and is working in Hong Kong. I wasn't going to speak, but earlier I received a letter from a student or group of students, university students, addressing me as a electrical member of the pro-establishment camp and a member of the Hong Kong Youth Council. They challenged me to read their letter. That letter is basically a letter in criticizing the Secretary of Justice. They dare me to speak it and declare my stance. Mr. President, rarely I read letter, but this time I'm going to do it. I'm going to speak why I read it later. The letter is so, dear Honorable Abraham, and now I now read the letter. Justice is often said should not only be done, but also seen to be done. When British Chief of Justice, Lord Hillwood, ruled in favor of an appellant in 1924, he actually set an even higher bar. He said, I'm reading the letter, I quote, "A long line of cases shows it is not merely of some importance, but is of fundamental importance that justice should not only be done, but should manifestly and undoubtedly be seen to be done," end of quote of the letter. And I continue reading the letter. "Justice," as he mentioned now, "has neither been manifestly nor undoubtedly seemed to be done in our way, for justice has dismissed the CY Leung case. Justice often defines definition, but even the humblest citizens will recognize injustice when they see it. A Hong Kong University poll shows that 3 in 5 residents disagree with SJ's handling on this. I am one of them," that's the student. The reason I want to read this letter is I want to defend the very rights that the Hong Kong citizens have to exercise this freedom of speech And that for that reason, I take up the challenge and read the letter and continue reading the letter to show that they do have their rights. And I do also hope, Mr. President, that they do respect the right of the Secretary for Justice in exercising her power under Article 63 of the Basic Law. I now continue to read the letter. A major bone of contention is the decision not to seek an independent assessment of whether to prosecute. A week ago, the letter says, the SJ tried to validate her move in this chamber. She noted, over the past 3 years, the prosecution division offered over 13,000 pieces of legal advice a year, save for those involving members of the DOJ. She stressed the division sought outside legal advice only once when whether to prosecute. She implies that there is nothing out of the ordinary not to brief out the Leung's case. I continue reading the letter. This is a classical example of beguiling with statistics. Let's look at the other side of the coin. Over the past 3 years, the public have not questioned the prosecution's divisions on its 39,000 or so occasions of not breathing out. There, however, is a deafening public outcry over the particular case. After all, in the entire history of Hong Kong, we have only come across one and only one chief executive who have failed to declare that he had taken $50 million without tax for a commercial agreement that had remained in force while he was in office. I'll continue reading the letter. We are not saying the facts are tantamount to a breach of law. We are only assert that the case is complicated enough to warrant a second legal opinion. This indeed is so intriguing that it took ICAC 4 years to investigate. The anti-craft agent must have assessed a reasonable amount of evidence since 2014. It has appeared, to say the least, presumptuous to brush aside such efforts before having assessed by an independent legal expert. Last Boxing Day, continue reading the letter, the SJ first broke a 2-week silence on the subject. She explained that the Justice Department have not sought legal advice on the payment for Leung, because it only did so primarily for cases involving internal staff. But the Bar Association and the Law Society have taken exception to her position. She has subsequently adjusted herself by affirming the 6 circumstances which warrants external advice. One of these is, end quote, to address possible perception of bias or issues of conflict of interest. It is, I continue reading the letter, it is not just bias or issues of conflict of interest. It is possible perception of such. The Leung case has produced screaming headlines for years. It is alarming that it has not dawned on our SJ that the decision not to consult was doomed to trigger possible perception of bias. And so they continue. And finally, I just jump a few pages. Continue reading the letter. Just one word of advice before I rest my case. The inscription, the case of the students, not my case, the inscription over the 10th Street entrance of the U.S. Department of Justice building, Washington, D.C., offer us some food for thought. It reads, justice in the life and the conduct of the state is possible only as first resides in the hearts and soul of the citizens. This is a reminder for all those entrusted with safeguarding justice. The way justice is administered in the case in question simply has failed to resonate in the heart and soul of our fellow citizen. End of the letter. Mr. President, I read the letter, as I said earlier, to defend the rights and that which all citizens in Hong Kong have to express their their free will and their speeches of the freedom of speeches. Now I like to touch on the letter. In the speeches given by the opposition party and contained in this letter, actually revolves around two concepts: the concept of legality and the concept of legal discretion. I found this very interesting, having spent hours listening to the speeches. I tried to search for the fact among the speeches of the opposition members. Have they been doing that for a political show? No, they didn't. What are they trying to talk? They're trying to establish that the established conventions of seeking outside help for legal opinion is important, no doubt. It is important. But then I ask myself, not seeking legal discretion and asking for independent help, was it illegal? I could not see then the illegality in not seeking the legal opinion from outside. It is courageous of the S4J to embark oneself to carry out the duty under the authority given to her under Article 63 to give a judge, to make a decision on this particular issue. And this is only legal with the legality that she has exercised that decision. I applaud her for her act on this and putting an end and giving justice to CY and all the others involved. We have gone through the issues, this particular issues in we have select committee on CY, we have a committee looking into the case of Zhao Houding, which is still undergoing investigation. I'm not going to mention this. But the whole case revolves around that not exercising legal discretion on the part of SJ is nothing wrong and is nothing illegal. She has her decision to make, and she made it in this instance by herself and her department. I totally support that. Mr. President, as my time is coming close to it, I'd like to declare, as the student has asked me, to declare my stance. I'd like to declare my stance. As a pro-establishment member of this council, and as a legislator, I'm obliged to honor what is enshrined in the basic law. Article 63 stipulates that the Department of Justice of the HKSAR shall control criminal prosecutions free from any interference, despite some of the pitfalls of the Secretary of General in not explaining fully to the public. The motion before us is tantamount to an interference of the DOJ's prosecutorial purview. I therefore cannot support the motion. And with this, I end my speech.
Dr. Cheng Chong Tai, my speech is not going to be long. I believe I'll be the last to speak on this motion. I think my feelings are mixed because in 2014-15, myself and people in the same camp already saw the death of the rule of law. So it's not about declining the rule of law, but rather the rule of law is dead. So this here is just a political operation, and the PAN Democrats may consider it from the perspective of procedural justice, and that is about the transparency of the process and whether the secretary's decision has sufficient basis. From my point of view, this is just about the operational aspect. If CY Leung's UGL case is so fine, so okay, how come when he assumed office and when Carrie Lam and John Zhang competed for the seat of the CE, they mentioned a review of Section 3 and 8 of the Prevention of Bribery Ordinance. And the secretary has decided not to press charges against Siwai Leung. As for declaration of interest, because there is no interest, conflict of interest involved, there is no law for him to require him to declare the amount of money he received out of an agreement with UGL before he assumed office. And therefore, the fact that he has not declared is not against the misconduct in public office. At the last question time, I asked Carrie Lam whether she has read this statement, and she asked me to read this statement further. She said that it's not about conflict of interest or declaration, but it's clearly said here that the accusation of making no declaration, well, because he has no conflict of interest and therefore he's not bound by law to declare the amount of money he received from an agreement he concluded with UGL before he became the CE. And that's why we should amend Sections 3 and 8 of the Prevention of Bribery Ordinance. There is a loophole there. And why do we still have a chance to debate on this matter? I think perhaps it's because of an oversight of Holden Chow and also a Freudian slip by Siwai Leung in May 2017, perhaps we still have an inkling of the rule of law, and then we set up a subcommittee without any power to summons public officials to investigate into the case, and then there was evidence in the interim that there was some collusion between Siwai Leung and Holden Chow. So under public pressure, ICAC formally opened a file to investigate a case in July. If not for that event, we won't have any chance to discuss this matter. So we talked about legal points and whether the process is transparent and whether independent legal advice has been sought. Well, if the SVJ knows how to play the game, she, of course, will not seek legal advice from Rimsky-Yun, but what if Wong Yan-Long? And the secretary claimed that she has shouldered full responsibility. Perhaps not. Well, Holden Chow and Siwai Leung were stupid enough to have left clues for us to follow. And ICAC started an investigation, and then public pressure forced the matter to continue to evolve, and you finally make that decision. So politically, if there's no case for UGL and CY Leung's agreement, how come he was not allowed to serve a second term in the seat of CE? Now, in Hong Kong, we don't have universal suffrage. We have no say over who should be the CE and the political appointees. Well, there is a small circle election by the selection committee. For reasons unknown to us, how come Siwai Leung was not allowed to take part in that CE race? Please return to the debate. Well, I have always been in this debate. Now, this is not a simple legal procedures, and the contention is not about the legal provisions. This is a political issue. All 7 million people in Hong Kong would like to ask this question, including people like Dr. Junius Ho. How come he was not allowed to serve a second term? Has he committed any offense? Why? What are the reasons behind that? The public may guess that perhaps it is because of the UGL case, or he has made some mistakes in his governance, and therefore he did not have the face to seek a second term. Of course, that is not. Perhaps he has committed an offense. Well, perhaps we have seen too many things in it. In July 2017, on May 2017, there was this incident, and then an investigation was launched by ICAC, and we thought that finally he would see some consequence. I think politically speaking, the SAR government owes Hong Kong people an explanation. We, the pro-establishment camp, thought that Si Wai Leung did an excellent job, and so why was he allowed to serve a second term? Because he had a pain in his leg? Of course not. And therefore, so many members have asked for an account of this matter. It's not just about this case. Rather, we want an account of how come Si Wai Leung was caused so much turbulences in Hong Kong. It's passed for years. In my view, the rule of law was dead during his term. And after he's left, Hong Kong is not restored, has not been restored to its regional situation. Mr. Cheng Chung Tai, may I remind you once again not to digress? All right. Otherwise, I will ask you to stop. Now, I'm going to finish. If we have the rule of law in Hong Kong, how come people like Junius Ho can be a lawyer? Thank you.
Wu Jiwai,
Mr. Wu Jiwai, President, I've been following the speeches this week, especially those from the probation camp, and that Mr. Dennis Kwok's motion serves to challenge the power of the DOJ and claims like that. The doubt is why the SJ decided not to follow the practice of the past SJs, especially when there were public concerns over perceived bias. You should have sought advice from briefed out counsel, but you didn't do it. Under the basic law, we understand that the DOJ enjoys some maximum rights under Article 63 of the basic law, and the right for the CPG to interpret the law is also transcendent. And some people even say that the Chinese institution can be applied to Hong Kong. But are these conducive to one country, two systems? And whether the DOJ's decision could help distinguish Hong Kong from other mainland cities, and that is, there is still rule of law. Like Ms. Abrams-Chack and other members said, access to justice must be something which can be seen, and this is also an important part to the work of the DOJ. Under a common law jurisdiction, many issues would follow convention, and not everything is in black and white. Something that is not unlawful might not necessarily be good, because it could affect public impression on the work of the government or DOJ. Unfortunately, you only offered a brief statement to explain your decision, and you cited insufficient evidence. If such deduction came from a briefed out counsel instead of from the DOJ, I'm sure the general impression would be very different. for the basic law, the Hong Kong government and the central government, if you seek to maximize your rights as a way to deal with the political conflicts, the much cherished one country systems would lose value. Everyone is equal before the law, and this is enshrined in the basic law. And all along with the challenges faced by Hong Kong, we might not necessarily like the decisions made by the courts, but we still respect them. The reason is that we trust that the court's decisions have the have their jurisprudence, and such jurisprudence is laid bare to the public. And for decisions made by the CFA, whether you like it or not, we would accept them. For instance, the CFA explained that the CPCSE interpretation would have a binding effect on the laws of Hong Kong, and we had to accept this fact, or the NPCSE decision. Even since a decision was made, we asked the central government and Hong Kong government to be prudent in using such tools. If there are no bounds, then we might start jumping to conclusions, and this is not conducive to resolving the conflicts, and this is what the Democrats have said. It takes a very long time to build conventions. According to the guidelines on briefing out of cases of the DOJ, the fourth criterion is to address possible perception of bias. So when dealing with decisions that might give a possible perception of bias, briefed out counsel would be sought. And such practice started from the time of the three previous SJs, Rimsky-Yun, Wong Yen-Long, and L.C. Leung. Like Abraham Shack said, your decision is not unlawful, but you overturn the convention adopted by your three predecessors. So what would be the traditional convention going forward? Would this be a singular decision made by yourself, or are you still going to consider possible perception of bias as you make your decisions? If you fail to do that, how can you convince the public that apart from seeking justice, the DOJ would make sure that justice is seen to be made? Or would this not be something you would consider? SJ, you are a politically appointed official. You are part of the politically accountability team. If you tell us that you would not consider this factor at all, I would just say that this is something you should consider when you act, and this is our area of focus. So to my colleagues from the pro-Beijing camp, you have been talking about our system and the rule of law. in order to support Teresa Chang's decision, you twisted our words and you made it sound as if we want to shift the focus. So what is the what is it that you want to achieve? Our intention is to enhance the governance of our society. Is this something not worth upholding? Should we not introduce checks and balances to our government? If our government does not have to consider all these when they exercise their powers, it would be a frightening situation. And as the majority in this LegCo, you are siding with those in power. So how would Hong Kong's benefit going forward? We know that Hong Kong is in a vulnerable position in terms of one country, two systems. In under Article 31 of the Chinese Constitution, the basic law was enshrined, and the SJ and chief executive must both consider how we can provide checks and balances to those in power so that we can prevent the exhaustion of power. If we do not do that, how can we face the Hong Kong public? And we would have failed in our role to protect the people. Madam Deputy, as we consider this issue, I hope colleagues would think more about our convention. And if the SJ wants to deviate or destroy that, do you have the right justifications? Or is this only an exceptional deviation? You simply have to explain the decision to us. And in the future, are you going to continue to resort to Article 63 and you will continue to exhaust all your powers? Or would you tell us how you would show the Hong Kong people that justice has been done? Thank you.
So, does any other member wish to speak? If not, first of all, I will invite the secretary to speak again, and then Mr. Dennis KWOK will give a reply, and then that would end our debate. The secretary, please.
I urge members to veto the motion on due to three reasons. Reasons of principle and one involving this case. First, Article 73, 5 and 10 of the Basic Law doesn't apply to Article 63 of the Basic Law because that would interfere with the Department of Justice's role in criminal prosecutions. Article 63 of the Basic Law states that the DOJ shall control criminal prosecutions free from any interference, including political interference. In the case of C, the judgment said clearly that the S for J in exercising this duty should be free from any influence from political or undue pressure. And Article 63 has pointed out that for the executive or LegCo to exert any political pressure, that would be in breach of Article 63 of the Basic Law. And this motion exactly interferes with my prosecutorial decision. I hope members agree with me that this is in breach of Article 63 of the Basic Law and must not be supported. However, the DOJ's prosecutorial decisions are subject to checks and balances. if the person concerned has got a legal basis, he may seek a judicial review. So there are relevant legal provisions. There can be a fair and just handling of the DOJ's prosecutorial work. And let me stress one again that in dealing with any matter, the DOJ will act in accordance with the law and will not be subject to any kind of influence or interference. And I'd like to comment on the briefing out policy of the DOJ. Now, I use the wording of the motion, briefing out policy. It's not that whenever the case is a sensitive one or when a senior ranking official is involved, briefing out is a must. Seeking independent legal advice before making any prosecutorial decision is not a norm of the DOJ. It is a norm of the DOJ to make prosecutorial decision by members of the DOJ. And as we have mentioned to the counsel before, when in making decisions on criminal or civil cases, depending on the circumstances of the case and where necessary, the DOJ can brief out the case for legal advice. I note in the debate that members refer to the briefing out policy or so-called convention or the norm. In fact, it's based on six cases. And I think Mr. Dennis KWOK mentioned that in his opening remarks in between 2003 and 2006. Based on the six cases, members of the view that for all sensitive cases or when a senior ranking official or incumbent or a formal senior ranking official is involved, then briefing out is a convention. I cannot comment on the six cases because that's the details of these cases. Whether an independent legal advice is to be sought is a professional decision up to the discretion of the person handling the case. We have to respect the professional decision of the person concerned. And I believe it is because of the special circumstances or legal needs of the case that briefing out will be considered. On the 16th of January, in my response to Mr. Eddie Ju's oral question, because he quoted three statements in 2002 and 2003, or 2012 and 2013, saying that it was a convention for us to brief out. And I mentioned that in those cases, he quoted no external counsel was sought to help. So it's not a must that a case must be briefed out because it is sensitive in nature. And then there is another argument that whenever a senior ranking official is involved, the case must be briefed out. Again, there is no hard and fast rule for members of the DOJ to seek outside legal advice because of that. In the past, we have seen serving or former senior ranking officials in the conduct of public office. And there were cases when outside legal advice was not sought and the decisions were purely made by members of the DOJ. As I said, I am not going to make a statement on cases where whether we decide to prosecute or not, and these cases will not be made public. Some members talked about briefing out, and I think they have confused the fact that the DOJ or the Secretary for Justice may delegate the authority to a member of the DOJ. Now, this perception is wrong. When the case has been delegated by the Secretary to a member of the DOJ, there is no conflict of interest involved. And when the member of the DOJ handles that case, he will still have to make a decision based on his professionalism, without fear and favor, and come to a conclusion. In some cases, perhaps the case is special, and therefore external legal advice may be needed to help him to come to a decision. But there have been cases where such a need doesn't arise. So there is no question of whenever a case has been delegated by the secretary to a member of the DOJ, it has to be briefed out. And our members also spoke at length on the possible perception of bias. Views are diverse. And it's exactly because of that, there have been case laws to provide legal definition for perception of bias. In English, we usually use the term apparent bias, and there is legal basis and certainty for this definition, and it's operationable. It is not just about how a person feels about that. And these case laws have helped members of the DOJ to deal with cases where there might be possible perception of bias. Perhaps the person concerned may have some relationship with the person involved in the case, and that is a guideline. And I'm grateful to members' acceptance that under Article 63, even after briefing out, it is the Secretary for Justice or the DOJ that makes the final decision. Now, if there aren't complicated legal points involved, and if the case, the facts of the case are not particularly challenging, why do we have to brief out? On average, we have given 13,000 pieces of legal advice, and over 10,000, and on average, over 1,000 charges were laid. And it was only in one case when legal advice was sought, even though a member of the DOJ was not involved. In the process, important figures and serving and former senior officials had cases involved, and indeed legal advice from outside counsel was not sought. As for whether this case will be reviewed and whether we will have an open discussion of the facts of the case, views are diverse. I will not repeat what was quoted from Barbara Mills and Thompson and Michael Thompson. I think they have set out the principles for when reasons for not prosecuting would be given to the public. In our prosecution code, we have said that we can only provide or explain such reasons as a matter of principle. We will not go into the circumstances of the case because it may be contrary to our public interest, that may be contrary to legal profession privilege, and there might be privacy concerns. Under Paragraph 23.4C of the Code, it is clearly stated that the giving of reason may adversely affect the administration of justice, especially in the case of a decision not to prosecute, where public discussion may amount to a public trial without the safeguards of the criminal justice process. The DOJ has the responsibility to ensure that publication of information is appropriate, and we has the discretion. We have the discretion to decide what information should be included in the statement and will not cause any injustice. After we've decided that a case should not be tried in court, any kind of statement, including producing documents and to discuss why a decision not to prosecute has been reached, can lead to a public discussion. and that case that may amount to a public trial without the safeguards of the criminal justice process, and it must be avoided at all costs. Now, if passing this motion, we may cause a public trial, it may undermine the rule of law, and it will deal a severe blow to the administration of justice. Based on these three principles, I urge members to veto the motion. Now, the fourth point is relatively simple. In December last year, there was an application for leave to the court for judicial review against the prosecutorial decision of the case, and the court of first instance has directed that a date be set for the hearing. As the case is now sub judice, it is not appropriate or possible for me to comment or supplement on the details of the case, nor should I produce any documents related to the case for fear of prejudicing legal justice. President, many members have mentioned the sentence. I'd like to respond in English.
Be done, but seen to be done. 我想大家都要記住另外一句, the benefit of justice being seen to be done must not be allowed to result in justice not being done. 如果通過這個議案, 我們造成一個
By passing this motion, we will violate Article 63 of the Basic Law. We may cause a public trial, and this is something that should not and cannot happen in Hong Kong. And therefore, I appeal members to vote against the motion. Thank you.
I will now call upon Honourable Dennis KWOK to reply. Madam Deputy, in the course of this debate, many members referred to Article 63 of the Basic Law. Now, the SJ went on to say that sponsoring this motion is tantamount to violation of Article 63 of the Basic Law. Indeed, that article gives a lot of power to the SJ.
Responsibility. 在行使這個這麼重要的權力的時候, 立法會責任也...
The LegCo has the responsibility to monitor the exercise of the power by the SJ, and the public would see the need to monitor the exercising of the power by the SJ. So the SJ can't say that I've got this power in the Basic Law, and so I don't need to care about public perception, that is how I exercise the power. Well, I'm sure the SJ would understand the spirit of the law. That is, it's a matter of how the public powers are being put to appropriate use and how the public powers are being exercised subject to checks and balances. You have power, but it doesn't mean that you can exercise of power without restraint. That's not the spirit of the rule of law that we understand. Mr. Wong Kok Kin quoted from a magazine. I don't know which magazine he referred to. I don't know since when the FTU has degenerated into such a state that is, they would just recite or quote from the editorial of a magazine instead of writing up his own speech. If he hasn't got time, Wong Kok Kin, please ask your assistant to write a speech for you. Don't rely on the editorial of a magazine as the basis of your speech. Now, he even said that we didn't elaborate on why it was wrong for the SJ not to engage independent legal advice. I think we have had a lot of information in the past few years, but we've got only a page or two in relation to the announcement.
Such interest to the relevant authorities. Since there is no conflict of interest on the part of Mr. Leung, there was no legal requirement for him to make the declaration. 即是说,
In other words, he would simply say that there's no conflict of interest and so there's no need to declare. But were we given the reason as to why it was believed that there wasn't conflict of interest? Well, UGL enlightened financially associated. Now, the UGL and Leighton belong to the same group, which is a listed company, CIMIC Group. It was in year 2016 that the purchase or the acquisition was made. At that time, Leung Chun-ying, CY Leung, was still the chief executive. And then in the year 2016, well, a major contract was awarded, that is Chang Kwan O Lam Tin Tunnel, of a value of $8.7 billion. That's what Leighton had been awarded. So by now, you know how many MTR contracts it has got. Sha Tin Central Line, Heng Yuen Wai Border Boundary Crossing. And then SJ, your husband is in the engineering field, so I'm sure through him you know that the company has got many government contracts and MTR contracts. In the year 2016, when CY Leung was still the chief executive, wouldn't he know how many contracts Leighton had been awarded? In the same year of 2016, UGL was also acquired. When the acquisition was made, the UGL asked the CE for service and asked him to comment on the offer price. Would UGL ask him as to whether further contracts would be awarded to Leighton? So tens of billions of dollars of contracts had been awarded after discussion by the CE in council. Did your one-page statement explain the intricacies of such matters? Anybody can easily find the information, and this is evidence by searching online. In 2016, there were hundreds of billions of dollars worth of contracts were awarded, like SCL, Heng Yuen Wai, Boundary Crossing Points. Well, the CE at that time should know that UGL was having a discussion with Leighton in relation to a merger. So please show us the evidence. Did you ask whether CY Leung had talked to UGL? Are you dismissing them as totally unrelated? If you do think so, please follow the practice, the convention of the DOJ, and what the Director of Public Prosecution had been doing. Former DPPs and also many senior criminal prosecutors under you told me, Dennis, this is most problematic. If I had been in the shoes of the DPP, I would have done the following. Certainly, this is a case that should be briefed out. It is highly complex, involving a former CE, involving a lawmaker from the pro-establishment camp. You would surely agree that it is sensitive. And then many doubts, a lot of evidence, many questions, many issues pointed out by the public as well as the media. How come you can simply dismiss it to say that there's no conflict of interest? And then you say that there's no need to declare. How can you believe that you can convince the public? Think carefully. Please don't destroy what has been established. That is the convention established by the DPP. You have been in the post for less than a year, but do you know how many fiascos, how many blunders you have carried out? You have got unauthorized building works, and then you said that you weren't aware of the basement. Now for this saga, you only gave a one-page statement, you went on leave for 2 weeks, you held a press briefing at the airport, and then you thought you have resolved this controversy. SJ, please understand, please try to find out why we are still so doubtful. Now, in fact, many MTR contracts have also been awarded to Leighton. And who appointed the chairman of the MTRCL? It was the CE, the CE in council. And then for the Review Hui case, what did the CFA judges say? If you apply the same logic, then probably Rafael Hui has been wrongly sent to jail. If you take the logic of the so-called principles aired by the SJ. In paragraph 97 of the judgment,
been charged with a substantive offense of misconduct in public office for failing to disclose his receipt of the payment when acting as chief secretary. But as Mr. Perry, 当时的 Kim Hong Kun, rightly observed, such a charge would not properly reflect the criminality involved in this conspiracy. 简单地讲就是什么话？就是终审法院认为啊。
So in simple terms, the CFA was of the view that if it was simply a matter of failing to declare the acceptance of money by Sun Hung Kai, then on its own it's a matter of misconduct in public office. But then he wasn't prosecuted for this charge because of a much larger conspiracy. However, in paragraph 97 of the CFA judgment, it was said that non-declaration on its own is already an MIPO offense. Well, I think you should have given an explanation. That is why there was this ruling in paragraph 97 of the CFA case. And yet, in this case, CY Leung didn't declare. But then it did involve UGL, and then Leighton was acquired by UGL, and then there were lots of contracts. And still you think that there's no conflict of interest. You should have explained the matter. I don't think you can dismiss us by having one page only. I don't think when you were arbitrating in a case, you would not conclude a case by having a one-page statement. You won't find it acceptable. Have you ever written a judgment that is a one-page length? I don't think so. For such an important matter, you would not be happy. You would not be satisfied with a one-page statement. A moment ago, Mr. Junius Ho gave a speech. I think you were trying to use the term frivolous. Frivolous. Please say that again after me. Thank you.
如果这个
He said that it's really bad for Dennis KWOK to move such a motion. He said that it would cause a lot of casualties. But then he used to talk about kill without mercy. How come that he worries so much about causing casualties here if I move the motion or when I move the motion? Well, please clear up the concepts before you engage in a debate. This is a member's motion. Priscilla Leung and the SJ also emphasized that we should look at it from the angle of a fair-minded person. It seems that it's more convincing when they use the term in English. What is meant by a fair-minded person? Do you think that it sounds more convincing and people would be worried and afraid? And don't you think that people know what is meant by fair-minded and gong dou in Chinese? Please stop having such a tactic. If you think that if you talk about apparent bias, fair-minded person, as if you can't say it in Cantonese, or if you think that you can't say it in the language that people ordinarily use, well, are your arguments convincing? If you go to see the people in the districts, talk to them by saying fair-minded persons. Priscilla Leung, Junius Ho, when you go to meet the people at the district level, talk about fair-minded persons without apparent bias. Use such terms in English in your slogans, in your pamphlets. Now, So you say that you are not irrelevant and you know the pulse. So when you meet your voters, talk about apparent bias, fair-minded person. I have got a few minutes left. I don't see Mr. Houghton Chow. Probably he's trying to avoid the limelight. Do you know the role of lawmakers? We are here to monitor the government. We should hold the government accountable. We press the public officers to give us explanations. That's what Mr. Horace Cheng has been talking about. that is the role of the lawmakers. Well, if this is the case, then please don't collude with the CE. We were investigating into the CE. How come that that lawmaker was having a conspiracy with the CE? We were there to look into the matter. How come that you have a collusion with him? Do you know what we lawmakers are supposed to do? So don't start talking about the responsibilities and duties of lawmakers. Don't you think that is shameful on your part, the AB members? Dr. An Zheng, Mr. President, in relation to the case of Houghton Chow, well, a committee has been set up to look into the matter. What is your point of order? Now, Mr. Dennis KWOK should not be using phrases, terms like conspiracy, collusion, etc. This isn't a point of order. Dr. An Zheng, please take your seat. Well, if any member doesn't like the wording that I use, if you would like to amend it, please tell me. Please email me, and please make sure that you use track changes. Otherwise, I don't know who has carried out the revisions. Now, it has been said that there's no hostility on the part of the government because the investigation covers a former CE, that is CY Leung, as well as Houghton Chow. So it is not a matter of hostility, a public figure of hostility. I don't know what they talk about. All I know is that for such public figures, they have all got important public office. And then for the six cases that I've referred to, and the SJ has also mentioned them, when we talk about people occupying important public offices, we hope the government would do the right thing and engage an outside legal opinion. This is because, dear AB members, we have very high expectations of the ethics of people in public office. So for Houghton Chow to conspire with the CE, members of the public turned to you and asked you to have high standards because we have seen in previous cases there were a former FS, a former CE, and also a former CS. So the people know, we know that we are fair, DAB members.
I now put the question to you. That the motion moved by Mr. Dennis KWOK be passed, will those in favor please raise their hands? Mr. Dennis KWOK claims a division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes. President, I have a point of order. I realize that Mr. Holden Chow has returned to the chamber. I wonder he would declare any interest, and before the vote, I would like to know whether he had consulted CY Leung. This is not a point of order. The decision whether to declare interest or vote lies with the members themselves. Please remain silent. Voting begins. Please check your votes. Voting is closed. The results are shown. From the FCs, 34 present, 9 for, 24 against. From the GCs, 32 present, 15 for, 16 against, 1 abstention. The question is not agreed by majority of each of the two groups of members present. I declare the motion negatived. Debate on motion with no legislative effect. Motion on enacting legislation to protect the rights and interests of rare disease patients. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button.